Good morning. Welcome to the Panama City Commission meeting. This morning, we're going to have, well, should I talk about what we're going to add to the agenda first?
We'll do that.
After that? Okay. First, we're going to have the opening prayer with Pastor Randall Ericks of Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. Thank you, sir.
Please bow your heads and join me in prayer. In the name of Jesus, we invoke the presence of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, our loving Father, through the grace of your Holy Spirit, you call us into your holy presence to be your holy people. Empower us to love you with our whole strength and with our whole heart, and do the things that are pleasing and holy in your sight. Gracious Father, we pray for the nation and those who govern, that our leaders may be people of integrity, and that we may be good citizens together with them, wisely using all the resources God has supplied for purposes consistent with his word and his purpose in Christ. Bless now the service of all of our commissioners and city officials here in Panama City. The years and the months following Hurricane Michael have provided a plethora of special tasks and responsibilities that without your strength and blessing, we would not be able to accomplish. May all their decisions and work be to your glory and to the benefit of your children here in Panama City. In Jesus' holy name and for the sake of his kingdom, we lay these petitions before you. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We do have one item to add to the agenda, item 9S. Can I get a motion to add this to the agenda?
Yes, Madam Mayor Pro Tem, I'd like to move approval that we add item 9S to the City Commission meeting this morning.
Okay, now we have retirement recognition for, yes? Oh, sorry.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
The Mayor Brunicki is not here today, and Mayor Pro Tem Halagas.
Yes.
Madam Mayor, I'd like to remove item 6C under me. This has to do with the sewer utility easement, and there still needs to be a refinement of the legal description. And I just, let's vote on it.
I'd like to move approval then of removing item 6C this morning. The request to release existing sewer utility easement, that item, and based on the recommendation of our city attorney, that's my motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Halagas?
Yes. Okay. Item 4A, retirement recognition for Robert Allen Page.
You can look no further than Robert Allen Page, who we're honoring today. Robert Allen has been in service his entire career. In fact, he's been a pastor for over 30 years before he came and started working with the city of Panama City about 6 years ago. And when he started, he was bivocational. He had the skills of an electrician, and he came and joined our team as an electrician. And then quickly, through his leadership, he became a foreman and eventually supervisor, and eventually became our chief coordinator for our projects as it related to our FEMA reconstruction efforts. Robert has poured himself into this community, and he's done an exemplary job, and of course, no one can support our city any better than those that support them at home. And Marlene, thank you so much for supporting Robert Allen not only here with the city, but certainly in his career in ministry and serving others. And today we recognize both of you on the occasion of this retirement and thank you for your service and say well done. Thank you, sir.
We do need to do roll call and approval of minutes.
All Commissioner Brown.
Here.
Commissioner Rader.
Here.
Commissioner Nichols.
Here.
Mayor Brodnicki is not here. Mayor Pro Tem Commissioner Halligan.
Here. Okay, now will be audience participation for anything that is not on the agenda.
Ms. Mayor Pro Tem, you want to approve the minutes?
Oh. Okay, let's approve the minutes.
Move approval of the minutes.
I'll second Commissioner Nichols' motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Halligan?
Yes. Okay, we are on audience participation. So if there's something that is not on the agenda, now is the time to come up. Okay, Frank?
Frank DePinto, 1400 Gulf Avenue, apartment number 4. I have three brief statements, 256, okay. They're about the Civic Center and the development of our community after Hurricane Michael and the recovery efforts and master plan that we've been going through for the last 9 months. I feel the Civic Center and boat ramp need more emphasis than it has been getting and communication with the city and community. Repair, rebuild, or a new Civic Center building. That is what I think should happen. I think that's what a lot of the community would want. I've been outside collecting signatures and people get very passionate about keeping the Civic Center and boat ramp parking. Keep it at the marina and save the boat ramp parking. The marina Civic Center could be rebuilt or new building with the insurance money that a lot of other buildings have gone through in the city. The city needs to sponsor a city forum to establish a dialogue with the community about the Civic Center and boat ramp parking area. Topics for the forum, amount of insurance money to cover, repair, rebuild, or a new Civic Center building. The potential plans as per recovery documents, page 99, of destroying the Civic Center and boat ramp parking and instead building condos and residential at the Civic Center site. This needs to be talked very openly with the community and they need to respond to this concern. Three, the most important thing for me, not that I win or lose, but the most important thing is that we get an accurate consensus of the community concerning the issue, starting with a Civic Center forum. Thank you.
Right. Anybody else like to come?
Selena Brown, 1222 Yale Avenue. I've been here before, and that was with the problem of on Yale Avenue, the lift station being partially on my property. That we have not resolved, and I don't know if we will or not. But in the process of having underground power and TECO gas coming out, running to make sure they didn't cut any lines, found out that the city water and city sewer is about 6 feet inside of my property. So the city, I don't know if they go out and just put lines wherever they want to without a survey, but somebody put it on my property, which I didn't own at that particular time. Okay, So the only thing I requested, I've had a couple of meetings with one of your, not any of you, but had a couple of meetings, and I was dismissed, totally dismissed. Said that that it had been there over 7 years, it was the city's property, and there was nothing I could do about it. And all I requested was to please, I would like to have city water. Since your lines are already on my property, I didn't think that was an unusual request. And I was told that the city was not in the habit of giving away city water for people that weren't in the city. And my next door neighbor has city water. She's in the county. My son's in the county, and he has, you know, city water. And I was told that that was done before he was in office or whatever. So I just want to know, I can't come to any reasons with this gentleman, so I thought, well, I'd put it before the whole commission and see what y'all think about people, you know, the city taking land and just saying there's nothing you can do about it, so be it. I don't think it's right. I don't think it's right.
Can I ask you one question? Excuse me. What was your address on Mill Avenue again?
It's Yale Avenue. It's Yale? 1222 Yale Avenue.
Yale. Oh, that's in my ward, yeah. This is the first I've heard anything about.
Well,
this.
I was here a couple of months ago.
I'm talking about a private one-on-one or something.
But that was about the lift station,
which
they're out there working on it this morning because it stinks to high heaven, which I have to live with, Aunt.
Well, I will be happy to meet with you, and I know the city manager will be happy to meet with us together. I know.
I've been trying to get a meeting with the city manager, but I have not been able to. I'm sorry, I haven't.
Ms. Brown? I know you're here a couple of months back. I can't remember, two, 3 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
I think you were back and brought that up. And again, is none of us probably hear when the water lines were put in there.
Mm-hmm.
So the questions that I would have, and I'm going to get Mr. McQueen to address you to meet, and you can get that publicly today, is a lot of times we get easements, and they go across people's properties.
Yeah,
I'm just saying, we don't have to answer
the
question today, but I'm going to have Mr. McQueen address you and do that and go ahead and get that meeting scheduled for you today. So, Mr. McQueen.
With Mr.
Yeah, because the county put their whole ditch on my property. So, you know, I've got the county and the city taking my property.
Well, thank you for coming today.
Ms. Brown.
Hang on a second.
We'll get your contact information. If I could ask you to meet with Jane Greathouse at the very end afterwards, or if you could just give her your phone number, I'll be glad to set up an appointment with Mr. Rader and myself. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else that would like to come up?
Good morning, Mayor Pro Tem and Commissioners. I rose to address the issue with the Martin Luther King.
Dr. Wood, would you state your name and address, please?
I am sorry.
I'm sorry. I should know it by heart, but, you know.
Rufus Wood, 1911 East 10th Street. I apologize. I understand that you have made a commitment to renovate and rebuild the MLK Center and the gym. And again, I was at the town hall meeting, so we're really excited about that and looking forward to that. I think the issue that I raised at that meeting, we've got a lot of kids now, and I think Mr. Carlisle was there and mentioned about 200 kids that we really need some activities for. I mean, again, we're excited about what you're gonna do, the vision that was put before us, we're excited about that. But in the meantime, I guess the critical question is, what are we gonna do for the children? And I understand Mr. Carlisle had a meeting with Mr. McQueen, and he was supposed to get back in touch with me, but I haven't heard anything else on that. But during the Christmas season, we had a Christmas party at our church because I was concerned about the children in the community where I pastor, and we had a lot of kids to show up. And so, again, I'm just very much concerned about it. In the meantime, while we're waiting for the renovation of that facility, what are we going to do with activities for the children? Are there any funding that is available that, you know, we can help our children in the meantime while we're waiting on that? And that's kind of one of my issues that I'm very much concerned about, you know. So I wanted to address that. The other thing that I wanted to find out about was the education issue as it relates to the two schools in the city. I brought that up a couple of months ago, and I hadn't heard anything else as it relates to that in terms of Oscar Patterson and Oakland Terrace, the two schools. I understand that the school board and the city were having meetings with plans for those two schools. But again, the mayor said that the community would have input. He assured us of that, but that's been a couple of months ago. And again, I haven't heard anything on that. So I'm very much concerned about that, to make sure that the community does have input so that we will know what's going on. Again, it's been real quiet. I haven't heard anything on that. So those are two issues that I want to see if we could have addressed.
Dr. Wood, thank you so much for loving the kids so much. I appreciate all the advocacy you do for them. I know that Mark could probably follow up on something as well, but education is quiet because it's slow. It's government, and you've got, there's a lot of work to be done. And believe me, I can't speak for everybody up here, but I know I'm not an expert in education, so I promise it will be brought to the community when there are decisions to be made. But that doesn't mean I'm not still passionate about it or working on it. It's complicated, I guess. And it's not just those two schools, actually. It's the focus of the five public schools inside the city. In addition, though, you talked about Mr. Carlisle. I know that Ty Ferris, Quality of Life, has met with him. I know that, Mark, you've met with them as well. And the city is just waiting, on, as far as I understand, a document from him that's going to be, it let us know explicitly how the money would be used in the sense of the programming and those kind of things. So absolutely, we're working with them. And I think that Ty would probably have the most up-to-date information. But absolutely, we know how important that is. We heard it at the meeting, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure that we're taking care of the kids during this time. So thank you. Mark, do you have anything you want to add to that?
No, I mean, we're just about to finalize that agreement with them with Mr. Carlisle on how to expend the funds for that. We just want to make sure that the background checks and those types of things for the volunteers that are going to be involved in that. So.
Good deal. Is there anybody else that wants to come up and address the commission? All right, well, then we are on to the city attorney, Nevin.
Thank you. The first item is ratification of extensions. These are extensions number 61 through 65. This is the extensions of the declaration of the state of emergency, and the appropriate action would be to approve for the mayor's signature extensions 61 through 65.
I'd like to move approval, Madam Mayor. Item 6A, which is the ratification of extensions to the declaration of state of emergency.
Have a second?
Yes, I'd like to second it, Mayor.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Next item is a proposed right-of-way use, development use agreement with the Branches, and their LLC is Trick Daddy Properties. I just wanted to say that.
You're going to skip that.
No. But this is for the history class brewing company, and it's to allow seating on the back on Park Street and allow seating also on the sidewalk in front, and there'd be an awning. And the right-of-way development use agreement gives permission similar to what the City Commission did for St. John's Catholic when they built an awning over the street right-of-way, and also for Trigo's where they have seating in front. Everything in the agreement is subject to a development order being obtained and approved. The development order would have to comply with building codes, other provisions, and I added a sentence yesterday that even makes it was already pretty clear because it said that the owner would have to apply for and submit final plans and specs. But I added a sentence that said the development order shall address issues such as application of the ADA, Americans Disability Act, appropriate markings on the pavement related to traffic, the design of the bollards, the planters, and the location of the vertical supports to the awning. And Mr. Branch understands that this allows the use, but it's conditioned upon obtaining a development order that's been approved by the planning department. This does not have a termination date, but it can be terminated by either party by giving notice. So, I mean, it's not 10 years or 100 years. It's just, while it's there, they would have insurance and they would abide by the provisions in the development order.
Any discussion?
I would like to call Mr. Branch up just to talk about the excitement of his new place down in downtown and a couple of questions for him.
Good morning. Alan Branch, 316 Park Avenue. I brought my business partner, Tim Whaler, at 3213 Goldenrod Court. Tim is a city planner, so he's going to answer a lot of the right-of-way questions. I'm just here for a good time. Happy to answer your questions.
I like it.
You want to just start talking about it?
Yeah, talk about your project.
Okay, so this is it's actually two sort of items. It's a right-of-way in the front, the sidewalk, as mentioned, for an awning that has support posts in the sidewalk, which is every little downtown I love, they have canopies and awnings that are supported in the sidewalk, create sort of, you know, intimate spaces. And it's really the back part of Park Avenue, which is split into two parts. It's an unstriped road. Currently, I'm using it for dumpsters and piles of bricks. And it's a community space that's similar to Treewell, similar to Trego, but it's also really similar to the space between Millie's and the Corner Pocket, which is a public space. We don't own the space. Anybody around us can use it for whatever events they want. I just maintain it, and I pay for all the bollards and all that stuff. The next step, as Mr. Zimmerman mentioned, is going into a development order, which would require engineering to make sure everyone stays safe in the property. We don't want anyone to get hit by cars. We want to be good stewards of the property.
So the project looks good. I like it, and like you bring the outside seating. A lot of people want to sit outside, and so it's good that you got it in the front and back, so that's good. And I kind of like that design, too. So the one question I think I asked you earlier was just kind of how you're going to protect that seating area in the back. And so you come up with some designs, then I think you met that traffic engineer back there to maybe assist you as well, or however that works. So you know that based on when we start doing the downtown and doing the improvements, that some things might change on that. You're aware of that.
It's going to be a collaboration. You know, this is a great between the charrette and this sort of collaboration between city staff and us. It's a collaboration to rebuild the city.
So I think in the charrette plan or the plans that you had for downtown earlier had some designs with the awnings and some outside seating and stuff as well, right?
Yeah, this plan was this is a drawing in page 95 of the charrette master plan thing. This is my playbook. Richard Dover gave this to me and said, "This is your 30-year playbook." If I take meeting notes when Mr. McQueen speaks. And it also has my plan in it. And so this actual drawing is a plan that Victor Dover put together. And it also includes not only, you know, in theory, we're taking parking spaces from the back. But this plan actually shows two more spaces being added. So we're really just pushing the spaces over and sort of avoiding that odd splitting of the road.
You did a great job with the little warehouse in the back where you put your residence, so that was good. So I'm excited about your project.
Well, as a neighbor, I don't want something ugly and unsafe across from my house. I'm not building a brewery that's gross and dirty. I want something beautiful around my house, so that's the intention is.
Alan, I'd like to just say I appreciate you, buddy. I've known you a long, long, long time. And whoever did all the specifications on this
we don't usually get that
well from you know that in depth what type of joist and
clamps and things like that, but
I support you. I appreciate your investment and that you
believe in our city. You could have gone anywhere and invested if you had, but you're third generation, I think, right?
Third generation,
and that carries some weight with me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, well, y'all know how I feel about you, and I think this is great because what you're doing is pioneering through, and it's been painful, I know that, for all of us, But you're really a pioneer, not just for downtown, but for all the enclaves of historic areas, St. Andrews, Millville, and Glenwood, and it's I can't be more appreciative. You know that. I feel like you're like a gift to me during my time. So can I get a motion?
1 minute.
Well, everybody's giving one. That's wonderful.
We all move.
We all move, yeah.
I'll second.
Well, I'd like to say before we give a motion is I've been knowing the Branch family for long time. And even with Mr. Branch here now, he and I have time to give little conversations. And I haven't ever seen the Branch family do anything that was disrespectful, bad, moving, or anything since I've been in Panama City. And I've been here longer than him. But anytime they want to do something, I'm looking for something positive, and he'd never fail me yet. I'm ready.
It's a wonderful thing to say. Awesome. Okay, so we have a first and a second.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Absolutely.
Thank you guys.
Madam Mayor Pro Tem, I draw your attention, as well as the rest of the commission, to item 7A, which is the final reading of Ordinance 2710.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use located at 418 West Baldwin Road. As background, the applicant would like to change the land use and zoning to be able to build an office building. The property is currently vacant, and it's owned by, and the owner and the applicant are both Rick Tolson. Planning Board did consider this item on its November 4th, 2019 meeting, and the request was approved unanimously. The recommendation is to move forward conducting the final reading of the ordinance.
This is a public hearing.
So would anybody like to come up and speak? Okay.
Adams, address is 3102 Florida Avenue. Can you not hear me?
Thank you.
Christy Adams, 3102 Florida Avenue, Panama City. I live right behind that piece of property. It's a skinny rectangular lot that's behind my backyard. And I'm just concerned, I guess our lot, we have an acre, and we were only allowed to build on a tiny little skinny strip because it's all conservation land. So I guess I'm concerned about this because this is not a big piece of property. It's real narrow. So I guess I'm concerned about it, you know, all that still, I'm assuming that's conservation as well, wetlands, because we had to demuck to build our house.
Here at 3102?
Mm-hmm. So I'm on the corner of Baldwin in Florida. And so there's an office they built a few years ago next to it. I haven't had any problems with that office, insurance, like agency. And it's behind houses. They had that changed. But I guess I just want to make sure that all that is still, you know, followed. And I don't know if there's really that's really room for parking and all that. I don't know. But I guess the conservation part is concerning to me.
Well, I think that's a very good question. Yeah.
It's pretty strict, all those rules. And
May I ask staff, if we have met with this,
do not. We do not know.
When I went to the planning board meeting, they just said an office for logistics for their company. So I don't know if, you know, it's going to be like a metal building thrown up or.
Ms. Adams, thank you for coming up and bringing this forward. It is an issue when you start talking about wetlands, and I know exactly where you live. And. This process would just go forward with regard to the zoning, but what would happen is there would have to be a development order if this is approved by the board. And that development order is going to have to address each one of those exact concerns that you've raised, which are extremely valid.
Yeah, I've never had to do anything like this. So I guess, would I be notified of anything too? Because, I mean, it's going to be behind houses. And I guess, like, the insurance office they built it is beautiful. It's a beautiful building. And this, I'm kind of like, would we still be, you know, would it be something that's decent built all around these houses? I don't know.
There would not normally be another public hearing with regard to that development agreement, but I can certainly make sure that we have communication with you on that to make sure that your concerns are voiced to the owner.
my view from the back.
Yeah, you bring up all good points, because once we approve it, then, you know, it goes through the development process on there as well. And I know that we've talked for the last several years on our main thoroughfares not building metal buildings,
right,
that they fit the neighborhood and do those. Mm-hmm. And we've stopped.
Well, post hurricane, I see some just popped up all of a sudden, you know, randomly. I'm like, oh gosh.
Yeah, I agree.
Right. No, you're right.
Actually, do you have any more questions, or is that what you want? Okay, well, if you will take a seat, we'll address a little bit of this. We can bring Mike Lane up, which is our planning. That's okay.
All right. Thank
okay.
you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mike, do you mind stepping up here for a minute? It does say, Brandy was just pointing out, it does say that it's 95% wetlands, mm-hmm, but that doesn't mean you can't develop on wetlands. Mm-hmm. But is there, I mean, after the storm, I know we've gotten to be sticklers, and then somehow she's right. We've seen, and we're going to address this in another item later, but there has been some buildings that have popped up. And this has also given us an opportunity to rebuild and to have better materials and more attractive streets and those kind of things. Is there any limitation on materials that can be used on that corridor?
I believe the Baldwin Avenue area is part of that corridor overlay. Most of the streets, you know, 390 and 77, 23rd Street and 98, even Business 98, are actually in that corridor. So, I mean, but, you know, we always talk about adding some additional streets.
And we have. We've gotten a couple streets that have come in mind since after the hurricane that are already are important corridors that are business that you don't want to look industrial as they're going through. I don't know, Mike and Kenny, Billy.
No, I agree. My thought in my mind was that we weren't allowing any metal buildings on our corridors. Baldwin is a huge corridor, and we're doing a lot of annexing in that particular area as well. So we definitely don't want to be annexing people in and allowing them to build, you know, metal buildings there. I mean, because you can see it, if I'm on both sides of the property, I don't want a metal building next to me.
And there's a lot of residential on Baldwin still in and around it.
Yeah. Good commercial, good office. And two is, so once we approve this, they're going to have to come for a development order. And that is going to set the stage for everything they can and can't do and what we're going to require them to do. So they're going to have to talk about parking. They're going to talk about the wetlands, the size
materials
of the building, everything that's going to kind of fit to that particular piece of property. I guess the question is are we protected to make sure that if we approve it, that our code doesn't say they could build a metal building in there just with the facade in front, but the sides going to be metal? You know, again, I don't want to approve something today that somewhere down the road they say, hey, your code says you get to do this.
I'm fairly certain that we do have limitations for that. I mean, I don't have the code in front of me, but I'm pretty sure that we do talk about no metal type buildings available or from view of any public street or any major corridor. So, you know, we can take a look at that and come back on that. But I'm fairly certain that the metal building issue is going to be Baldwin. Now,
is there any way to appropriately vote for this with? I don't think we can do that.
Let me ask it this way: Is there can we postpone it for 2 weeks to get these questions answered for more global picture? Put it to the next 28th meeting or whatever, and just move from there. There's no rush on some type of. Or if the property owners here and they want to talk about it, have them step up and just kind of talk to us about their ideas and what they're committed to.
Is the property owner here? They'd like to discuss or anybody like to represent? Evan was going to give a suggestion too.
Okay.
It'd be fine to do this next meeting, but one thing that you could do is that if the corridor overlay does not cover Baldwin Avenue, when this is approved, you could give direction to your staff, mm-hmm, to start working on an ordinance that would add the Baldwin to the overlay. There is a principle in Florida law that says that it's called the pending ordinance doctrine. If you are working on an ordinance and someone comes in to try to beat the clock with the development that you can just not process it until you get the ordinance done, provided it's a short period of time. So that's, but that could also be done in 2 weeks, and then we could flesh out what this pending ordinance, what this ordinance is that we're working on.
After Leslie speaks, Billy, you can give us your feedback too, since it's there. Okay, Leslie?
I just have to give my 2 cents. Leslie Fontaine, 305 Bunkers Cove Road. I know we call it the overlay, corridor overlay. I like the word gateway better, because it's the first impressions that people see when they come into our towns, our town. And I would like, I just hope moving forward, we want to be better than we were. So I'm hoping when we do things like this, let's look at how we're doing it, because we're going to set the precedence for these kind of things. And we want to, you know, I agree, I don't want to see a metal building when we come in, but let's do things right. Let's improve. Like Mark McQueen says, we're going to be better than we were. Let's make sure that's what we're doing, that we're not just allowing anything to pop up. We want things to look better than they did before. We can do this and be better than we were. And that's one of the things when Victor Dover came in, he encouraged us to let's look ahead. Let's look ahead at what we're doing. So I commend you for kind of looking, stopping and looking at this. And
thank
I appreciate
you, Leslie. So how about we just postpone?
We need a motion to postpone.
Okay.
A motion to continue to the next hearing, which or next meeting, which I think is the 28th of January.
I move to postpone this general item number
7A, 7B.
7A and 7B. I didn't want to say 7C, but 7A and 7B. To the January 28th meeting
to address these issues.
Second.
Second the motion.
Yeah, I'd like to just want to say one thing. I'm very sensitive to our citizens. I'm the first person, all of us are. We do not want to do anything in a negative way that will hurt anybody's property values or your, you know, what's behind you or beside you, because we put ourselves in your position. We wouldn't like it either, so I'm with you. But also very sensitive to being pro-business. So I think we got to find a happy medium there and work together, you know. And I'm probably different than anybody. When you kind of use a term like metal building, people kind of have an idea. But I've seen some gorgeous metal buildings. You wouldn't know they're metal, with beautiful facades and brick on front of them, you know. So I think we need to be careful, say no metal. You can. I just, that's just me. Maybe I'm thinking out loud, but I was even seeing gorgeous theaters in Branson, Missouri, Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, that you wouldn't know are metal. They have cobblestone, brick, and beautiful facades on them. So we always consider that being added to the. Yeah. I'm just saying, you know.
And it's not just on that. It's all around the city. So, yeah. But yeah, thank you. Okay. So we have a first and a second.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Thank you. Item 7C.
Vote on 7B or
I think
just
7B? Oh,
he did.
That was
okay.
A and 7B.
You got it.
Item 7C is a final reading of Ordinance 2711.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use located at 1028 Mulberry Avenue. The applicant would like to change the land use and zoning to be able to build a duplex on the property. The property is currently vacant. SS McNeil LLC is the owner and Samuel McNeil is the applicant. The Planning Board did consider this on their November 4th meeting of 2019, and the request was approved unanimously, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
Public hearing, Mayor Pro Tem.
Would anybody like to come up and address this item? Okay. This particular outlaw, I guess I'll say something if that's okay. Does anybody else have anything they'd like to say? This particular address is right there and across from the News Herald and things like that, and I didn't have any issues with it, with this particular Mulberry property. Not that it matters what I think, but it's my district, so I went there and checked it out. So that's all I have with that. Looking at duplex would be good.
It's not facing
11th Street, is it? It's one block
Yep,
to the south.
Like one block back.
So I think mm-hmm.
So unless anyone has any issues or any discussion, we could get a motion on that.
Move approval of item 7C 2711.1.
And a motion, ma'am.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission has approved ordinance 2711.1 and ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for a parcel of property located at 1028 Mulberry Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, providing severability, and an effective date.
Item 7D is a final reading of ordinance 2711.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 3, MU3, for the property located at 1028 Mulberry Avenue. It's the same information as I've previously provided to you, and the recommendation is to move forward conducting the final reading of the ordinance.
This is still a public hearing, Madam Mayor.
Okay.
Move approval of ordinance number 2711.2.
Second motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission has approved ordinance 2711.2 and ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 1028 Mulberry Avenue, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 0.16 acres, mixed use 3, providing for severability and an effective date.
Item 7E is the final reading of ordinance 2712.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use located at 1130 Mulberry Avenue. The applicant would like to change the land use and zoning to be able to build a duplex on the property. The property is currently vacant, is owned by SS McNeil LLC, and Samuel McNeil is the applicant. Planning Board did consider this on its November 4th 2019 meeting, and the request was approved unanimously. Recommendation is to move forward conducting the final reading of the ordinance.
I'd like to move approval of item 7. Oh, sorry.
This is still a public hearing for this. This is a new address on Mulberry. Would anybody like to address the commission? Is there any discussion? Okay, I'll discuss. This is actually on the other side of Mulberry, 11th Street. And if y'all remember, we had a really nice couple that they bought a lot on that side of Mulberry, and we denied the change because they wanted to put air conditioning business there, commercial, but it was particularly air conditioning, I just remember that. So my question really is for Mike. You know, I think the desire here is for a duplex, which is fine and dandy because it is a strong residential road right there. There's a lot of people who still own on that on that road and really have a desire to keep it residential. Obviously, they bought their houses residential. They want residential around them, and duplex is certainly residential. But in this mixed use, I mean, it sounds like you could put commercial as well. You mind coming and asking that? Thank you.
Because it is mixed use, yes, it could go commercial right there. Interesting thing, though, is it's a very, very tiny lot compared to what most commercial districts or most commercial parcels are. I mean, for them to be having to account for stormwater and various, you know, the parking requirements of offices and that sort, it's going to be challenging on the size of that lot for them to do that.
So I don't understand this, how we have, like, we'll have all these different zonings, and we can't, is it illegal for us to do a zoning change, but have but it only, you know, be built for what they're saying it's going to be built for? I mean, why can we not say, yeah, we approved this zoning, but it's got to be what you're applying for, is for the for a duplex?
Well, there's a R3, I guess. Is that R2?
What is R2?
We have an R2.
And what is that? Is that a duplex? Can you do a duplex in an R2?
Can. It's tied to density. Right now, the R2 is a 10 unit per acre requirement or for density. This is actually a 20 unit allowance for the mixed use.
If it's such a small lot, why?
Paul, when you look at the tiny lot and when you compare that density requirement, I mean, it just bumps it up to where it could be a duplex or a triplex in density.
But in R2, it still could, too. You just can't do commercial.
Well, here's the thing. If you multiply, I think where the lots are like 0.13, and when you multiply 10, it comes out to 1.3. It doesn't bump it up to a 2, to a duplex. You know, duplex is considered two units. So, you know, we only have that other 20-unit density, which when you multiply density, that 20 times 0.12, it bumps it up to 2.6. And because it's over 2, that's a duplex-type number.
I guess you could do is based on the, I think that the first one we approved was a 50-foot lot. They're putting a duplex of two units on it. Mm-hmm. And this is a 100-foot lot. They're going to put four units on it, if I'm understanding mm-hmm. correctly. And so I think the only other way to do it is you would do some type of deed restriction on it, saying that you're going to build these four units, not a commercial building with air conditioning or heating or whatever it may be that the issue we had before to protect you.
I mean, why can't we do that?
Did you do that?
It was kind of an academic question. There is a zoning that only allows residential duplexes, and I realize that the problem is density. Mm-hmm. So rather than dealing with changing the density in residential zoning, developers come in and they would like mixed use because that gets them the density that they need. You typically don't do contract zoning where you require individuals to do a particular thing in the
when you zone. Mm-hmm. You can't make them enter into a
contract. We'll rezone you if you do a building that looks like this or it's going to be this use.
That's why we have to have it written in our codes, how it has to look.
So there probably should be an R3.
We could certainly plan for something
or change
like that
the density,
a higher density
in R2. Yeah. I mean, that's the issue that pops up from time to time, is there's not enough density in R2.
I personally don't have a problem with it.
Ask the applicant what their intention is, but you're right, that's not legally binding.
I just know that this commission denied that change for a prior person on that particular road. If you go down that road, it's like going down a residential road in Millville, and somebody put in commercial. And I know they're not planning on doing that. I just wanted to figure out how we could protect the citizens and protect the city from them doing anything different than that down the road. But right now there's not if we pass this. But people put money into this process. And I feel like they shouldn't have to get this far. I feel like they should be able to go to the city and never have to get this far and know that their likelihood of getting approved is, you know, because they do have because we've been given the weapons to do an R3 or something else so that we can still give them what they desire and protect the city at the same time. But you're telling me right now there's nothing exactly we can do besides approve this, and then we've approved it for them. We denied it the year before for somebody else. The exact same zoning. So, I mean, I just want to be fair and consistent. And I want to absolutely allow this development to happen. I think duplexes would be fine on that road, but I don't feel comfortable doing it, knowing that down the road when I'm long gone that, you know, I don't know. Not there yet with that. So is there something we can do for them where they don't have to go back and pay the money and do all this stuff? I mean, can we not? There's got to be a solution to this.
One idea is to continue for 2 weeks and let staff try to give you some thought out possibilities. And the thing that comes to my mind is that you change the density and allow what it is that people are trying to achieve by going to MU, a mixed use designation.
Mike, I was going to ask Sean if you wanted to come up here and talk. Thank you, Mike.
Sean McNeil with SS McNeil LLC.
475 Harrison Avenue. We will put a deed restriction on the property that we will not put any commercial development on the property. We'll put a deed restriction on the property that will only be residential.
Well, that solves that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sean.
We can accept a voluntarily offered deed restriction.
Well, with that in mind, I would like to move approval of it. Since he's willing to do that.
With the deed restriction as residential. Sean, thank you for making that a lot easier than it.
You cleared that up, buddy.
But it doesn't mean we don't still need to address that.
And I've said that for years, and it's a system that is really, it kind of trumps us with the state, with the LDR. I think Mr. Zimmerman could explain it better, but that's why we've always had to have attorneys from Tallahassee to help us with the LDR and comp plans and things like
that. So do we have a second?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Okay, the commission has approved, and the minutes will reflect that there was an acceptance of a deed restriction from the owner, and then the approval of ordinance number 2712.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for a parcel of property located at 1130 Mulberry Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for a repealer, severability, and an effective date.
So item 7F is a final reading of ordinance 2712.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 3MU3 for the property located at 1130 Mulberry Avenue. It's the same information as I previously stated, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
Still a public hearing if anybody wants to come up. There.
God bless
you.
Should have said up front.
As a matter of course, Sean McNeil, 475 Harrison Avenue. We will also restrict the same property with the deed restriction to only put in residential. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean.
Y'all have a good day.
All right. Can I hear a motion?
What was that? Said, have a good one.
What was the
deed restriction?
Same thing. Yeah.
The motion.
This property?
We got it. It's the same property.
It's the same property. Same,
I'd like to move approval with the deed restriction added to it as he.
Second the motion with the deed restriction.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission has approved ordinance 2712.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for a parcel of property located at 1130 Mulberry Avenue, Panama City, Florida, providing for a repealer, severability, and an effective date.
So item 7G is the final reading of ordinance 2713.1, which is the voluntary annexation of 0.172 acres of property located at 1124 Bay Avenue. The applicant has requested annexation into the city in order to utilize city services and build a single family residence. The property is currently vacant. Leland Gaines is both the owner and the applicant. Planning Board considered this item on November 4th, 2019. The request was approved unanimously, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the request for annexation.
This is a public hearing, so if anybody would like to come up. Morning, Mr. Henry.
Morning. Walter P. Henry, 614 Maple Avenue, Panama City, Florida. Brother Gaines had called me about this, and piece of property that he's building his home on, and he wanted to know, and I turned him to the told him to talk to the engineer department. Also, I told him to talk to the city manager. I know that the city used it when they it's been a while that city put this sewer in here on this property in this down this street on Bay Avenue. And he's been told that he got to put a lift station in. I told him he talked to the engineer department, make sure that he got to put in a lift station. The man want to get by easy and give him, cost him more money, and then have something that he got to maintain for his life, or somebody, or some of his folks. And I don't believe that You know, I think I told him that they need to show him that he need to put in a lift station. If you don't need to put in a lift station, he should be able to grab it through that his sewer into that city line. I don't know how deep it is. My house sits about 100 feet away from city right away. And the sewer on my property that city have is about 3 feet deep. I can run 100 feet and get and gravity flow a sewer line. And I did my own sewer, put it in. And I was able to gravity flow in that city sewer. This house sits closer to city right to the property and city right away than my house does. And I feel if that sewer is 3 feet deep, either 2.5 feet, and it's sitting high up off of the ground, it's not, and that sewer ought to be able to gravity flow in there instead of him have to put a lift station in. I don't know, he talked to the city manager, he either talked to the engineer department. But I told him that's what he needed to do. He's not satisfied with it. He's working, and he can just get off and do what he want to do at any time. So I just I want to bring this to y'all point. I don't know before you do this because I don't think it needs to be done.
Can I ask a question? Are you representing the property owner, or just?
Well, he questioned me.
Fair question.
And I told him who to go to, he need to talk with. I don't know if this have been done, but I'm just letting you know the man is not satisfied. I told him to even talk to his contractor, tell him that he did not want a lift station. If he was able to grab the floor in that line, that's what he need to do.
I understand.
So,
you're representing him? I mean,
yes. Yeah, I just.
So a question, I know that a lot of the places on, and again, somebody's smarter than me on sewer lines, but I know a lot of places on 390 are actually putting in those lift stations because of the type of line that runs there, and I can't remember, I don't know if it's gravity fed, it's a different type of thing, and so they're putting in there, and I've actually been in this neighborhood and drove around there. And I think probably because of the main line of what it is that's why anybody that comes in is going to have to put in, I think everybody on that block of the annex in is going to have to probably put in one of those lift stations. So if Mr. Johnny could explain.
You're saying Balboa? I mean, what street you, what's?
390, 23rd Street,
390, 23rd. Yes, I understand that. If the line has been put in, it's not deep enough, it's shallow. You got to put in a lift station, but I don't think that.
I think it's called a sump pump.
I don't think that it's lift pump. You know, the lift station. You call it whatever you want. It's a station.
Mr. Sims answers.
It's just a smaller station than the one you said it.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Henry. All right, Johnny.
Council, Johnny Sims, Public Works Director. This is the first I've heard of it. But normally, what happens over on 390 is we have a huge force main there, and to get those people in service and get them part of the city, I have, through Mr. McQueen, worked a program where they can put a grinder pump, much like the beach has done some of the same thing, and Public Works is going to help them in that endeavor to get all that worked out. But in this particular case, I'm not familiar with it, but I will become familiar with it. I will find out the details, which I do not know now. I do not talk about 3 foot, 4 foot. I know what I'm talking about. So I will find out where this is at and come back and give you an answer.
So I guess question number one is the property owner's not here. So he wants to, okay, so he wants to be annexed in, number one. And then from there, he needs to work out the issue from that. So I'm going to make a motion to approve his annexation into Panama City. And then from there is for the property owner to get with Mr. Sims to work out the requirements of that.
We have a second.
Before we do a second, I'd like to say something on that topic. Well, on the Mercedes headed down along the bayou, quite a few people was having that problem because their house is located down here from the lift station. Every time it rains, they get a big rain, the sewage flow back. Mm-hmm. Then it fills up, and I myself have called the pumping station to come and pump it out. So that is a problem. And sometimes you do need a lift station of some force, a force main or something, to get it high enough so it can drain back down. So that is a problem, and I just kind of go along with Mr. Sims.
Address that somewhat.
But at this time,
on these private stations, and they're grinder pumps is all they are. They're not a real elaborate big station. They're just quite, I think Lynn Haven has 100 of them. We generally put a check valve just right at the property line so that force don't come back on the rest that he can only pump out. There's a lot of communities that went this way because they try to get these people in the community, get them paying into the water sewer service. They enjoy that benefit then over a septic tank or other problems where the health department has stepped in and said they got a problem. So let's just step back and look at the situation and we'll get back to you, let you know what the deal is, okay?
So that brings up a question. Okay. So again, yes, since the person is not here, mm-hmm. and we approve his annexation into the city, and he has to put this pump in, grinder pump, whatever you call it, and they don't want to do it, they still want to be in the city. You see what I'm saying? So again, I don't want to approve him for the city, so should we wait for 2 weeks mm-hmm. With these questions to let him go, Mr. Sims, well, and we'll bring it back on the 28th to approve him?
I think he want to come into the city. It don't make any difference. I hear what you're saying. I need to put in lift station for the city.
Okay, I know, but I just want, I'm talking about this particular property.
I know,
does he want to come to the
all,
city?
I know how it all works.
Okay.
I know how it all
works. Okay.
But I'm saying that you're not, he, this guy, how I'm looking at it and how he talked to me, this guy had not engineered this thing, see how, if it would get on. He just told him. That's what
okay.
he's gonna do.
Well, you know, we could, yeah. Thank you, Mr.
So, so he's not right. here, and he didn't bring the question up. I keep my motion yeah, approving a movement to the city.
I would like to add to that too, since the person clearly has desired to be that, and they're not here, and we have no problem with the annexation. Plus, there might be a little misunderstanding about what someone means as a, because I have a sump pump at my house, so it may just be simply a EPCI code plumbing that you know it might be might not be as anyway. We'll deal with that. I'm sure they'll come. Okay.
You still need a second?
Got it.
Thank you.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission has approved Ordinance 2713.1, an ordinance of the city approving the voluntary annexation of 0.172 acres of unincorporated property located at 111224 Bay Avenue, Bay County, into the city, further defined, amending the wards and boundaries, providing an effective date.
So item 7H is the final reading of Ordinance 2713.2, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of residential for the property located at 1124 Bay Avenue. It's the same information as I previously stated regarding annexation, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
Public hearing.
Anybody would like to come up? Okay.
Approval of ordinance number 2713.2.
Second the motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
City Commission has approved ordinance 2713.2. An ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of residential for a parcel of property 1124 Bay Avenue, providing for repealer severability effective date.
Item 7I is the final reading of Ordinance 2713.3, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of residential 1, R1, for the property located at 1124 Bay Avenue. It's the same information as I provided regarding the annexation, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
So it's a public hearing, if anybody wants to come forward. Okay.
Move approval ordinance number 2713.3.
I'll second the motion.
Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission has approved ordinance 2713.3. an ordinance zoning a parcel of property at 1124 Bay Avenue, Panama City, having approximately 1.172 acres, R1, providing for severability and effective date.
Item 7J is final reading of ordinance 2715.1, voluntary annexation of 0.187 acres of property located at 1938 West 24th Street. The applicant has requested annexation into the city in order to utilize city services. Property is currently vacant. St. Andrews Bay Land Company, LLC, are both the owners, is the owner, and Jacob Fish is the applicant. The Planning Board did consider this item on its November 4, 2019 meeting. The request was approved unanimously. The recommendation is to conduct a final reading of the request for annexation.
I'd like to move approval if it's appropriate. This is not a public hearing, correct?
It is a public hearing.
Oh, excuse me.
Oh, so it is a public hearing if anybody would like to address the commission? Okay. Seeing nobody?
Yeah. I would like to
Did we miss something? Because what about 24th Street?
That's what we're doing right now.
We're
7J. 7J.
That's a sweep. I mean, I see it on here being the same one. It doesn't look like the sweep bay one.
You mean 7I?
No, it was 7J.
7J. We're to 7J.
Yeah, I mean, I see where we are. It just didn't match up on mine. Okay, continue.
I would like to move approval of ordinance number 2715.1.
Second the motion on the dot.
This is a public hearing.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes. I don't have it.
Yes, you are.
Ordinance number 2715.1, an ordinance of the city approving the voluntary annexation of 0.187 acres of unincorporated property located at 1938 West 24th Street into the city as further defined, amending ward's boundaries, effective and including providing for an effective date.
Item 7K is a final reading of ordinance 2715.2, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation for residential for the property located at 1938 West 24th Street. It's the same information as I provided earlier concerning annexation, and the recommendation is to conduct the final reading of the ordinance.
And this is a public hearing. Okay, seeing nobody? Motion?
I would like to make a motion that we approve ordinance number 2715.2.
I'd like to second the motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission is approved. Ordinance 2715.2. An ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of residential for a parcel of property located at 1938 West 24th Street, Panama City, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 7L is the final reading of ordinance 2715.3, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of residential 1, R1, for the property located at 1938 West 24th Street. The background information is the same as I stated during the annex agenda request, and the recommendation is to move forward with the final reading of the ordinance.
Okay, public hearing. All right, do we have a motion?
Yes, I'd like to move approval of item 7, is that 7L?
Yes.
Yeah, 7L, ordinance 2715.3.
Second the motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Commission's approved, ordinance 2715.3. An ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 1938 West 24th Street, Panama City, having approximately 0.187 acres, R1, providing for severability and effective date.
Okay, now on the consent agenda, we only have one item. Exciting one, though, the St. Andrews Mardi Gras event. Anybody have any discussion about that?
Oh,
great. It's an easy one.
Move approval of the consent agenda.
Second the motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's talk about that afterward.
Okay, by the way, the reason I got a little flip there is because he said Jacob Fish, and I started thinking Sweet Bay. And so I was like, wait a minute, did we miss some of that? So, okay. All right, now, Mark, City Manager.
So thank you, Madam Pro Tem and Commissioners. I draw your attention to item 9A as the request for a public hearing for the draft development agreement between the City of Panama City and 1212 Beck Avenue, LLC. Submitted for your consideration as the first step in the approval process for this is for the public hearing is a draft agreement being negotiated between the City of Panama City and 1212 Beck Avenue, LLC. This is an opportunity for the city to move forward. We're grateful to the developers for their action on moving forward on the what has been known as the Cabana Hotel. And we think that this is a step forward for the community of St. Andrews. And I think that this is, as we continue to negotiate this is an opportunity for us to hold this public hearing for discussion concerning this agreement.
If I could add, this is a public hearing, and there are two public hearings, one today and one in 2 weeks, and no action needs to be taken today by the City Commission. The purpose is to get input and then have action taken in 2 weeks. The purpose of a development agreement, the City Commission has done this on a few occasions, but it's in this case, it's primarily to freeze the development land use regulations in place for a period of time. And also attached is a letter from the planning official that does not provide for any variances to the existing code, but it's simply an interpretation of the existing code that all the parties agree is that is the interpretation that the parties will abide by for the next period of time. So that's the purpose of that, and it is.
I just want to say that I had some questions about a period of time that we had applied here. And, thinking that through, if you're familiar with the property and what's located there, I mean, you've got some buildings that are there and you've got pavement. So, I understand that we build this back and looking at our code, it makes sense that whatever period of time that is good for St. Andrews and City of Panama City. And that I'm excited, and the community is excited about the property owner to be able to take the building down, because that's what people have been asking for at least the last 8 years that I've been in office. So it's good they're stepping forward to do that. And two is that at any time they could build something, and I think that with that building gone, it's probably a better opportunity for somebody to see a vision to build something based on what our current codes are. So I think something will happen probably within the next 10 years anyways. And we've done this in the past on froze our codes or the things that I'm thinking of. So I'm excited about it. And I look forward to approving this development agreement on January 28th.
Anybody else up here want to say anything or discuss anything? This is a public hearing, so if anybody wants to come forward.
I'd like to thank our city, excuse me, frog in my throat and he had his legs crossed or something. we all need to smile after that game last night. I'd like to thank, I think Mike Lane, like Mr. Zimmerman said, because I received an email, we all did, I think, the person was concerned about the state of how far you go with when you
take down a building.
But if a redeveloped property in the St. Andrews downtown district will not disturb the buildings, if a redeveloped property in the St. Andrews downtown district will not disturb the building's foundation and such foundation remains intact until the time for future development, the construction will be allowed in the area of this foundation without it triggering requirements for a stormwater pond on the site. And that's written, it's code, and I wanted to make that clear.
And we're not voting today anyway.
Yeah, but we asked for a discussion.
Oh, yeah. Well, I was going to say I'm going to get my little 2 cents now about this. I want to make this really simple. You know, there's a lot of commercial property in the city that has been destroyed or needs to be pulled down or whatever. We want them to redevelop the commercial. This is not something that you're trying to do a favor for somebody and not somebody else. Just like I said, fair and consistent. If I'm a co-owner in Toucans in Mexico Beach, and you know, we had a certain amount of bathrooms, and you have that. Now, we were completely destroyed. We didn't have a foundation, but had we had one, you know, this all this is simply saying is that we're going to just grandfather you into the same thing that you had before. And by all means, all research shows that that helps redevelopment. It certainly is not going to hurt St. Andrews to have a slab there instead of the building that's there right now. So I just want everybody to know this is a fair and consistent thing. This is, I've been approached about other complexes that are commercial that they're going to pay to have it all torn down, but they want to make sure that they get credit for their impact fees and the things that they had someone has already paid for. So I just want to make that clear that this is not a favor for anybody. This is fair and consistent for anyone. Anyone who hears this, if you've got a commercial building and that you want, this is what we need to do to redevelop. So I also noticed because Mike attached the code as it exists right now for St. Andrews. I didn't see where it was really asking for anything different. It was like zero setbacks already. Well, okay. I mean, all the things that it sounds like to me the only request here is to honor the code that's in place right now for a period of 10 years, to put it simple.
I think we just approved the code a year and a half ago. So it's new codes for us, or I think it was January, or it might have been 2 years, but we've just approved all those codes.
Yeah, so it protects the investor to know that, you know, that they are going to have the same benefits that those who exist in the St. Andrews district right now.
We would do that for anybody.
We would do it for anybody.
Downtown, building tears down, we'll let them put it right built.
So, I just want to make that
clear. I haven't seen or heard that one. So.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, okay. Well, we're going to be facing that in the Cove, and we'll probably be getting that for things in the Cove. So it's just, makes sense. So anyway. Okay. Anybody else have anything to say?
We'll put on that next meeting.
Next meeting.
That's right. So I draw your attention to item 9B, which is the final approval. The approval of the final plat for phase two of the Sweet Bay subdivision located near 3127 Lisenby Avenue, also known as the former airport. The approval of that plat is in May of 2019. The City of Panama City approved a preliminary plat and development order to develop the 68 acres north of phase one, Academy Park, for 227 residential dwellings. St. Andrews Bay Land Company now submits the plat for phase 2A of the Sweet Bay subdivision for approval and acceptance by the city. The planning board did consider this item on its December 9, 2019 meeting, and all board members voted in favor of the motion to recommend approval of the request. The recommendation is to move forward in the consideration of the final plat.
Of this item.
Second the motion.
Any discussion?
I don't see the exact number of this,
item 9B is in boy, so.
Let me
tell you, it's a great project. You're doing a great job. Homes are beautiful out there. I would probably, if anyone's here from them, or encourage them that if they could expand their on-street parking.
It gets kind of tough. When you're
driving out there.
I don't know if they could
gain them a foot. Mm-hmm. They probably need about 12 inches.
Because when you park,
on a road,
yeah,
and you're driving by, it kind of
might get clipped.
Might get clipped. If you're all small cars, it's a beautiful place. But if you got a truck and some of the other trucks I've seen out there, it's pretty high. So, but the project's fantastic, but just hopefully they can think about that as they develop these lots, if they can gain about 12 inches. I haven't called anybody in your district over there about it, but it's a beautiful, beautiful piece. Homes are well built. It's
good, but they should probably need to expand. I think Mr. Jacob might be able to look at that.
I think that that's kind of the point.
Yeah.
So that traffic stays extremely slow and cautious. But I don't know. I'm not the developer. But that, in Atlanta, they do that a lot, too. And so everybody has to be super slow, or it encourages people that live there to, you know, walk and bike.
I will say, Commissioner Nichols brings a good point up about, you know, it's all about safety. But and
I've not encountered that problem. But,
we are so blessed to have a development like that in our city. Yeah, we really are.
All right. So we have a first and second. We already did that. Okay.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
So I draw your attention to item 9C, which is great news for the city of Panama City. And it's regarding the consideration of the acceptance of a Hurricane Michael recovery grant and a budget amendment resolution number 20200114.1 in the amount of $1 million from the Florida Division of Emergency Management. As background, the City of Panama City, through our grant consultants, been awarded a $1 million as part of the Hurricane Michael Recovery Grant Program through the Florida Division of Emergency Management. The funding is for the operating deficits due to the immediate effects of the Hurricane Michael. The staff recommends that this $1 million to be allocated through the funds accordingly, which would be 75% of that, $750,000, to the utilities fund, and 25% of it, $250,000, to the solid waste fund. I'd be remiss if I did not share that we are very grateful to the governor for his approval of our request of this grant, and it is the recommendation to accept the grant and the approval of the budget amendment for this resolution.
I have a question. Who applied for this for us?
So we applied for a number of grants, three of them specifically for this program. This one here was secured by Mike Langton, and Langton Consulting.
Excellent.
They did a great job supporting this. And when I got notice of this, I immediately called Mr. Langton and shared our appreciation for his efforts in helping us to get this.
Just so the public knows, we've been using him for decades. And I think he's never gone up on his contract. It's like $3,000 a year. So we paid him $3,000
a month.
$36,000 a year. So that's quite a bit of return.
He does a phenomenal job. His entire team is just phenomenal to work with. We're very grateful to partner with them.
Awesome.
And this is yet another example of him coming through to assist the city in our greatest time of need.
Just wanted to give credit to that. Yeah. That's amazing. Mm-hmm. I'm sure everybody's going to accept this, but we need a motion to accept it.
I'd like to move approval of item 9C, acceptance of Hurricane Michael recovery grant and a budget amendment resolution, number 20200114.1, in the amount of $1 million from the Florida Division of Emergency Management.
Second the motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
The commission has approved resolution 22114.1. No. 22114.1. A resolution providing for the amendment of the approved fiscal year 1920 budget for acceptance of Hurricane Michael recovery grant.
So item 9D is a consideration of adopting the Community Rating System Repetitive Loss Area Analysis Report. As background, this is a detailed mitigation plan for the citywide repetitive loss area. This provides more specific guidance on how to reduce damage from repetitive flooding than a community-wide floodplain management or hazard mitigation plan. This plan can be updated annually by staff from information given by the public and other agencies that have more information about those areas defined in the report. As a recommendation, it's recommended that as part of the city's ongoing involvement in the CRS program, which benefits our citizens by reducing their residential flood insurance rates, the city's floodplain manager has developed a repetitive loss report analysis for the public to have access to. The staff recommends approval of the resolution to adopt the repetitive loss analysis report.
Yes,
I'd like to move approval of that, and I think it's wonderful. I just want to ask a question. I think we do this every year on a yearly basis, so you know, it's important to do, and it can save the citizens money in their insurance policies.
Second the motion.
Discussion?
Yeah, so kind of miss Mr. Bring it up. Yeah. Yeah.
So a question for you. So this is a report that we have looked in the past of those losses and to identify homes or properties that are consistently flooded, or is this going to be a new plan moving forward?
This is a new one, actually. This is in the same category as the one you're thinking of, the local mitigation strategy, which actually that's being looked at as well by the county. So they're fixing that one. So this was actually worked on before the storm, and it kind of had set back for us. And so now this is actually 140 points towards the CRS program, mm-hmm. which gets us even higher. Rating. Hopefully higher rating to get us to.
How does it work?
What do you mean, how does it work?
So when you do a community rating, is it determine the V zones, or it determines that this house is flooded once, twice, three times?
Oh, yes. Well, usually every year I get a list of repetitive loss properties, and of course that's private, so I mean only the owners can ask if that's a repetitive loss. But I take that and we take an area radius and find out which properties are in near those areas, and those are repetitive loss areas. And so we usually send out letters. That's something we've been doing to all the repetitive loss areas, saying, hey, this is what you can do, you know, purchase flood insurance, here's what you can do to mitigate your area to prevent flooding and all that kind of stuff. So this is just an analysis report to go over, and it's open to the public. They can come look at it anytime they want.
So what do we do? So what do we do with the properties that flood consistently? Are we doing anything with them? Do we? Because in some cases they're not required to have.
Right, because if they're not in a flood zone.
Not in a flood zone.
If they're not in a flood zone, AAE.
They tend to flood because of drainage or whatever it may be, or built on properties that were too low to begin with, but they're not in a flood zone. So do we assist those people or help them in a way of or getting FEMA to buy their homes or?
Well, that's also, some of this is also in the part of the drainage that we're going for the hazard mitigation. So some of these properties are actually in that drainage study that Hagerty is also working on to get the grant for that.
Okay.
So, and that's so, also in the report. That's also
but you're working
in the
on
report.
That as well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Great.
I have one more question. You brought up a great point. So I heard you say something about the city sends out letters?
Yes.
Okay. So, and you know, a lot of things were discovered during Hurricane Michael. My goodness, you know, things that we never knew existed with low-lying areas and things. But if you do not receive a letter and you feel like you have reason, a citizen,
can they come to the city and discuss that?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely, yes. So, and also in this report, I also put a kind of a survey in there that I actually would like to post online for any citizens that want to fill it out, saying, you know, this is, I flooded, and this is how many times I flooded, and they can turn it in, and then we can add it to the report.
Do they need to go to a particular department in the city hall?
I mean, they can come to me, or of course, engineering. Okay. They can go to engineering for flooding.
I appreciate
that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this is just it's staff. It's not, because I thought it was a typo that I saw that no money.
Vote to adopt.
Okay. Got it.
Did I make a motion on it yet? Kenny?
Yes,
or?
We did.
Okay.
Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
So I do thank Ms. Aldridge for her work on this, just to share. It's she's done an incredible job balancing not only this with regard to floodplain management, but also as our lead integrator with regard to our FEMA reimbursement efforts. So I do appreciate all of her efforts. Nevin?
And I would like to read the resolution. A resolution of the City Commission authorizing the city to approve Panama City Repetitive Loss Analysis Report.
Well stated. Okay. Item 9E is a consideration of final payment in the amount of $38,707.51 to C.W. Roberts Contracting Incorporated for the 2018 City Street Resurfacing Project. As background, the city contracted with C.W. Roberts Contracting Incorporated in March of 2018 for the resurfacing of portions of the 9 city streets and 3 alleys. The contract amount was for $404,405. The project timing and the project management were impacted by the hurricane. Michael, the total amount spent on this unit price contract was $387,075.10. The project is now complete. The release of liens has been provided, and the final amount due to the contractor for its 10% retainage totals $38,707.51. It's a recommendation to move for approval for the final payment to C.W. Roberts Contracting Incorporated in the amount of $38,707.51.
Well, once again, with staff being comfortable,
recommend approval. I'd like to move staff recommendation of final payment to C.W. Roberts Contracting.
Second the motion, Mayor.
Any discussion?
Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
So item 9F is consideration to reject all bids received for bid number PC20-006, which is the Martin Theater exterior wall repairs. The low bidder did not provide enough information for a thorough review. The other bidders exceeded the estimated cost for the repairs. The scope of the work is going to be redefined to better inform potential bidders and will be rebid. Recommendation is to move forward on the rejecting of all bids that were received.
Move to approve, Mayor.
Yeah, I would like to second the motion, but I'd like to put an emphasis on, and I know everybody feels the same way that I do, it's an ASAP thing with me.
Mm-hmm. We really need that venue, so we're going to do it either, right?
Yep.
Thank you, staff, for being very good stewards of that.
Thank you, Mr. Rader. I would just share with you that, in the wake of the storm, it was immediately recognized that the Martin Theater sustained substantial damage and more than likely should have been raised as a result of that. But clearly, it's an icon to our community. It is has historic relevance to our community, and we're very grateful to the Florida League of Cities and to Synergy for helping us navigate through this. But we need to do this in a prudent fashion, and our objective is to work on the exterior facades as we're working through the interior redesigns, because the desire is to, as you know, the DIB building, the old DIB building adjoining the Martin Theater, is going to now be integrated into the new Martin Theater footprint. So I think that our insurance company, and we're using DAG Architects as our architectural firm, is doing a great job of helping us to redefine the scope of each of these phases of work.
Appreciate you sharing it with us. That's good news. Just looking at the companies that bid, trying to find out the right question to ask, but it looks like they're all over the board. So was the scope not clearly defined? Two is, did the contractors come in and talk to us about what we're looking for to understand what the scope is? Because again, as I'm familiar with one of the companies that are here, the other ones I'm not,
but it's I kind of have an idea of what I think that the price should be on those. So mm-hmm. I'm just trying to understand is
the materials that's going to be used, the walls that's going to be good, mm-hmm. they're stripping the walls off.
Right. And I think we owe that to the bidders to be clearer in that process. And I think that's why DAG is going back and re-looking at how they had the verbiage in that prior to, so that we can modify what those exact specifications are. Clearly, as you indicate, it was all over the map, so it was obviously not clear. The contractors do work through Synergy, because this is a potential FEMA reimbursement, Synergy must employ the city's procurement process. And so as a result of that, Synergy is the focal point for any RFIs that come in with regard to this.
I'd like to see maybe get everybody, because the place is such an icon, is make mm-hmm. sure that we get all three of those in the same room to look to make sure that we clearly understand what we're asking for. Because this is clearly just,
it's all over the board.
Yeah. One looks like he's doing half the building, the other mm-hmm. one looks like he's doing
just the facade.
Two buildings, and one looks like he's rebuilding the building. Mm-hmm. So
right.
So it's just, I'm just
trying to understand that. But
yeah.
This also, we talked about, was this part of that roof design too, or is this just...
Just the facade.
Facade and painting.
That's it.
This is not the interior.
This is not the interior, nor is it anything regarding the green room with regard to taking off the gabled roof design.
Okay. And so what was the... What was the budget that we had for that? Is that something that Synergy said?
That's what they said, yes,
okay,
sir.
And they're probably way off as
yes,
in terms
sir.
Of their value, what their value is, too, because the prices are so high.
Exactly.
Okay.
All right.
Can I
sir.
Ask one more question?
Sure.
Was it the insurable amount? Is it going to be adequate enough to cover everything?
The insured amount is to rebuild the structure exactly as it was.
Okay.
If we go beyond that, it'll be to the city to pay the increased proportionate share for that.
But
applying
we're
insurance.
Cover to a certain amount,
mm-hmm.
And if we want to go above and beyond,
that's right.
That's on us.
Yes, sir.
That makes good sense. Perfect sense.
Okay. Any more discussion?
I want to get it done.
All right. We have a motion and a second.
Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
So I draw your attention to item 9G, which is consideration to purchase one CNG knuckle boom truck from Houston Freightliner in the amount of $197 and $197,580. This purchase will be made using the HGA buy purchasing cooperative contract. This is going to replace our current knuckle boom, which is in severely deteriorated condition. As we've seen, now that we've completed our last pass, we still have a number of citizens that are pushing debris and as they're doing smaller projects in and around their yards to the street, and now this knuckle boom will give us the ability to start sustaining ourselves. So with that, it's the recommendation to move forward in the purchase. This was a budgeted item in the previous year.
I'd like to move approval for the purchase of the CNG knuckle boom truck.
I'll second the motion.
And I have discussion.
I have a question. The knuckle boom is the one where they pick up the debris.
Yes, sir.
Off.
Right.
So I had an opportunity to watch the ones that we had, and the knuckle broom, the device that picks it up is probably might be adequate to pick up some yard debris,
mm-hmm.
But is there that's a basic one. Is there a better one that, because the lines kept busting, the hydraulic lines kept busting on them because the materials are picking up or maybe picking up too much. But if we look back at our maintenance history on those trucks, is this a better truck than what we've had in the past? Or is there a better boom that we could purchase for a couple more $1,000.
Right. This is a great question. The knuckle boom that we have is way beyond its useful life. It's been put together. It should have been replaced probably 5 years ago, but it has not been. And so we're expending an inordinate amount of money on maintenance and getting all those hoses up just because it's just flat worn out. We intend to dispose of that asset. And it probably won't yield more than just a small amount of money relative to this.
We have several of those, don't we?
We do. Okay. But this is the one that will replace our oldest.
So do we have different levels of,
we do.
Of boom trucks? So that way, if we do have a area in town that we have extra
larger.
Debris that gets, mm-hmm. that we have a maybe a better, stronger, well put together boom?
Yep. This won't be as large as the ones that you saw that Crowder Gulf had. That's pretty large. But this, we believe in our analysis, will do everything that we need it to do with the type of debris we typically pick up.
Mr. McQueen, I have a question. I was always talking no such thing as a dumb question. We buying a brand new one or one that's mm-hmm. a couple years old?
Brand new.
Okay.
And this is part of our life cycle replacement plan. As we're starting to develop for all of our equipment sets, we're also doing an assessment and analysis of exactly what type of equipment we have and that we need. We're employing a new philosophy for our equipment so that our teammates that are working hard on behalf of our citizens each and every day have the appropriate equipment set to be able to support what we're asking them to do. This clearly is the first step Fortunately, it was a budgeted item from the previous year, and we're now in a position to be able to move forward and secure it.
That'll help us. We desperately need it.
I'm very grateful to our teammates.
Do you have a motion yet?
Yes.
Yes.
Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
So I draw your attention to item 9H, which is the consideration to cover the cost of the upgrade of the lighting on State Avenue corridor from 19th Street to 23rd Street. As background, Gulf Power completed a field visit to the State Avenue corridor from 19th Street to 23rd Street. The following is needed to upgrade the lighting to an LED technology and greater enhance the visibility for citizens traveling in this area. Change 9, existing Cobra heads fixtures from the sodium halogen to the LED Audubon fixtures is part of this proposal. Additionally, it'll add 3 new LED Audubon fixtures onto the existing poles. And then lastly, it will install 1 additional new LED Audubon fixture on 1 new 35-foot wooden pole. Option 1 is the total cost for the poles, wire, and fixtures would be $22,998.33, and the monthly billing for the energy and maintenance for the fixtures would be $209 per month. Option 2 would be no payment up front, and the monthly billing for the poles, wires, and fixtures would be $425 per month. Once the initial cost is paid, the estimated net increase for the total utility would be $277 per month. Staff recommends approval on upgrading the State Avenue lighting corridor. This will help to solve a problem that Mr. Rader, you identified at our last commission meeting. I think also it'll serve as a model for our citizens to see what the new illumination package will be that we're working on with regard to addressing all of the lighting throughout the city as we address safety and security and key and vital infrastructure as part of our lines of effort for recovery.
Mr. McQueen, I want to thank you for working on this and all our other members of staff because it will be a great model for the city and so that the citizens understand it's only a $61 per month increase, you know, from what we're already paying on these lighting fixtures. We're going to have LED, so I'm very grateful. Very grateful. Thank you, sir.
All right.
I'd like to move approval. How about that?
Bet.
I'll second the motion.
I have questions.
All right.
So, as you jumped on St. Andrews with State Avenue, I'm jumping on State Avenue with St. Andrews. As we... this Gulf Power is doing this.
That's right.
These poles in.
Right.
And in St. Andrews on Beck Avenue, we own those poles.
That's
we
right.
own the lights.
Right.
Is it possible we could work out some agreement with Gulf Power to take over those poles and to replace those lights down there so it takes away from us and we pay a small minor fee and to maintain those on the corridors of Beck Avenue
because
sure. of State Road today.
Right.
In the future, it might be. It might be our road, hopefully, but Gulf Power still provide that lighting. So that was a thought that I had on this here because, we still don't have lights up on right. Beck Avenue, and my understanding it's still, they're coming.
They're coming.
Eventually.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely.
Gulf Power has been a great teaming partner. Not only did they come to our aid during the immediate crisis in the aftermath, but they have been a stalwart supporter of this entire community and certainly would be glad to explore what you're just asking with regard to that because they do a great job for us and they do a great job and in fact as you voted on last meeting we're riding on their architecture and many other things that we're doing with regard
we've
to
got
water
the poles building. And stuff mm-hmm. and they just if they have
they
the
have
lighting
right.
then hey let's pay them so mm-hmm. much a month and then we can just get the lighting from them
mm-hmm.
and would be good for that on Beck Avenue, and we could probably maintain the other lights on the other
side streets
just to keep mm-hmm. it, keep that feeling there. But on Beck, we
right.
probably need additional lighting. So
I totally agree.
A
And I would just like to add to that while we're, you know, adding all the lights in there that we obviously, we're obviously looking at this, I would assume we're doing the streetscapes. But also down Martin Luther King and in the Millville corridor, anywhere where you have a lot of people walking would probably be first. But I also want to add into there, I mean, that, that'd be interesting if they would do the same thing with the ball fields that we have.
And they are. We're already have partnered with them on White Field, and we're also working with them on Daffin Field. And so, again, they've been great teaming partners. The, you know, as we look at the illumination for the city as it relates to safety and security and to key and vital infrastructure, having this corridor on State Avenue as an example, that'll show people what the possibility is for illumination. It wildly changes the visibility on those types of corridors. Additionally, if you want to see what the impact is for a parking lot, you can go to, actually to Gulf Power's parking lot over off of 15th Street. It's very well illuminated, and you can literally read a book while you're out there in a parking lot, but yet it's more cost effective. And it's for those types of light fixtures where we would put them in a residential area, you can put a block on the back of it. It's, it helps to prevent the illumination from coming back into people's residential area, but yet it allows for the illumination to go down and out from the street. And so it's a really amazing opportunity for our community to literally change the look and feel, not only during the day, but also in the evening time.
And as I understand, because I went to one of their symposiums and spoke with Ms. Sandy Sims, which I, gosh, she's wonderful. And I think as their goal is to, as they replace lights, you know, in throughout, not only the city, but the entire county, is to go with the LED fixtures.
Right. Yeah, and it's not just a one-for-one replacement because of the way that the lighting pattern is. They actually can reduce the number of fixtures that are possible. So that's where additional cost savings come into it. And it's going to take a long-term plan and strategy to get the whole city re-lit. But we're really delighted to be partnering with Gulf Power FPL next gen to be able to do this.
All right, then. So
I would like to add a little bit, too, since everybody's throwing the 2 cents in. Well, now, I don't have too much to complain about because Ward 2 have been under construction for years. And the lighting is already being placed, already being in use. And but the only thing that we need to do now is get more into the inner streets. And with the outstanding possibility of things coming up out of Panama City North, which is part two, Ward 2, we're doing fine, but just keep up the good work. Keep it at a steady pace. Thank you.
Is there LED on MLK?
Yep.
Awesome.
There is.
Okay. That still doesn't seem quite as bright as I would have thought it would have been for LED.
But it's well
in fact, I think MLK was the second one. I think the first one was put down on the marina.
Good deal.
I absolutely love the lights when we redid the baseball field to the soccer field on 23rd Street.
Oh, wow, yeah. Looks great.
That shines.
Okay, so we have a first and second?
Option are we voting on?
Option two. I'm sorry.
Option two?
Right.
Okay.
Mr. McQueen?
That's what the staff recommended?
Yeah, it's option two.
I want to make sure we have that in the motion. So, yes, option two.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes, ma'am.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes.
So I draw your attention to item 9I, which is consideration to cover the cost of the site preparation work that is necessary for the new vehicle maintenance facility, which is an item we've been talking a few times in this commission meeting or in previous commission meetings. As background information, the vehicle maintenance facility sustained excessive damage from Hurricane Michael, but was reconfigured for temporary operations after the storm. City faced two options concerning any future vehicle maintenance operations. The first was to either rebuild the existing damaged facility using insurance proceeds minus the insurance deductible, or the second option was to rebuild the facility at another location using insurance proceeds minus the deductible and incurring any site prep work expense not otherwise covered by insurance. Site preparation is not covered by insurance for a relocation if the current site can be used. The decision was made to rebuild the facility at another location within the current maintenance compound. This decision was based on the fact that no viable buildings were available in the city to continue vehicle maintenance operations while the old facility was being refurbished. The price of the site preparation work is projected to be $456,870. This expense is not covered, recoverable by FEMA because the project is not eligible for the FEMA 428 reimbursement program. Conversely, there is a potential for the price to be offset by utilizing City Public Works to perform some of the site preparation tasks. Additionally, savings can be credited by utilizing some of the existing vehicle maintenance equipment in the new facility rather than purchasing and installing new equipment. It's my recommendation to move forward to cover this cost of the site preparation work and to obligate the money from the Hurricane Michael Fund. It's been a really difficult process that we've been employing. We've been looking at every option and every conceivable way of potentially keeping it on the same location, but the real challenge was where would we move the maintenance operations while that construction was taking place for the next year or however long it would take. This moves the maintenance building inward to the northwest corner of the compound that we have. We feel like it's higher ground. It's an ability to maintain it in a better location. It also allows us more flexibility with regard to where the current maintenance building is to create a shipping and receiving space and separating those activities from the myriad of vehicles that are within the compound itself. Creates a safer environment so you don't have a lot of truck traffic going on while people are moving around getting into their vehicles. We think that this is, we do know that deductibles in either case will be reimbursable from FEMA. So that piece, even though it's not here, it's an expense we have to make, and then we get reimbursed for it.
How much is
that? I don't know. I don't have that off the top of my head. I can get that for you, though.
Discussion.
Move approval of site prep for the new vehicle maintenance facility.
Second the motion.
Is that option two?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Yes.
I will vote, but I actually did want to say something. I just had a couple questions. One is I wanted to know about the deductible, and you said you'll get that to mm-hmm. us. But you also feel like, do you think that you can put into some kind of numbers where we'll be able to offset that? Like I know you say with vehicle maintenance, but to me, I don't really know what that means. Does that mean $20,000? Does that mean hundreds of thousands of dollars?
For the offset? That'll come from what we can harvest back from the current vehicle maintenance facility and not buy brand new equipment, but indeed if it was not damaged. For example, some of the lifts may not have been damaged. I know were not damaged, but some were. And so what we want to do is do an assessment of each one of those lifts, for example, and determine which ones are viable to move. And everything we move over is less that we have to purchase new in the new complex, the new maintenance building. So the top end, according to Synergy, is the $456,000. And anything we can do to help reduce that through internal work with our own maintenance department, public works department, will only reduce that amount off of there, which is healthy. So it's sweat equity, in other words.
Yeah, that is. I mean, especially if there's mm-hmm. some engineering involved.
And- right.
Yeah, anything else that
exactly.
might be involved. So, okay, I just want to make, I mean, there's just so much that needs to be done. Mm-hmm. And, you know, $500,000 is just, you know, that's a lot of money. And I want to do it right when we do it. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted, I guess in my mind, I just wanted to kind of understand. It sounds like from what you're saying, we maybe even be able to offset half of what?
Potentially. Maybe. Potentially. Okay. I don't know about half, but it'll I would estimate maybe upwards to a third. Mm-hmm. Additionally, in this new facility, it'll have some hardening in there as well, which will help us with regard to any catastrophic weather event in the future to be able to better weather a storm.
That's like a magic word, so. You say hardening, that also means, yeah, we can protect a lot of things that we weren't able to do this time.
Right.
My vote. I just wanted to make sure I answered those before I was comfortable with my vote, so yes.
Okay. Thank you for voting. Okay, so I draw your attention to item 9J, which is the, and many of the new items are mostly first reading. So 9J is first reading of ordinance 2716.1, consideration of the future land use map for the Millville Downtown District. On March 26, 2019, the City of Panama City Commission approved ordinance number 2675, which amended the land development regulations and included standards for the Millville Downtown District. The Millville Downtown District text was incorporated into the city's land use development code as section 104-35. However, the associated future land use and zoning maps were not adopted at that time. The Planning Board considered the items at its regularly scheduled meeting on December 9th of 2019, and the motion was made to recommend approval. All members voted in favor of the motion to recommend approval of the request, and the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance 2716.1, consideration of the future land use map of the Millville Downtown District.
First reading of ordinance 2716.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to include the Millville Downtown District category to the Millville Community Redevelopment Area to provide for severability, repeal, or effective date.
Item 9K is the first reading of ordinance 2716.
That's okay.
I'm sorry.
I just want to, Mike, do you mind coming back up here really quick? Sorry. My mic's coming up here. There's been some construction in this corridor. I've had a conversation with Mike about this. There's a metal building that went up right in the middle of this district. Although I do appreciate the business, that got ahead of us somehow. And would this have changed that the ability for that to be built if it had been recorded and voted on before that moment? Does this code protect from metal buildings in that district?
Not sure that this area does have that provision in that
okay.
zoning district.
So what led me to this was that, I mean, this old, old, historic, not very big corridor right. district right there. When I talked to Mike, he said the only thing that would protect them would to be in a tourist, what'd you call it?
Well, the gateway overlay district.
Yeah, which it absolutely should. So I didn't know if this was related to what I had talked about, or if this was something different. And if it's different, that's fine. But it's really important to me to see if there is a way, and I don't know if this is something we can do today or we can add it to the agenda next time, that I would really like to change the code that be in that gateway corridor. I mean, we haven't done the charrettes in there yet. We haven't done anything. I don't want any development to change the historic, and it needs protection, and I'm not sure how to accomplish that. I need to do that.
Yeah, I'd like for the staff to look at that and create options for this council to consider at our next one, but I think there are some options that we can employ. I've seen other communities do things that have created a pause while there is the process moving forward to create that
and I hate
overlay.
To say pause like any, because there's development. That's, but if we do a tourist one,
right,
then people can still develop. They just can't do metal buildings on that corridor and maybe some other things. So like Nevin said earlier, if there is a conversation that the code could be changed, then Mike has the ability to tell somebody when they come in, hey, you know, this is in the process of maybe the code being changed. There's got to be something we can do to preserve just that block,
right.
You know, for, or two blocks, for just, I mean, there's no reason why if the downtown has that and St. Andrews has that Millville
shouldn't
have that. So
right.
What I'd like to do is when we come back in 2 weeks, if we could just change that to the tourist corridor, then that will eliminate that at least for a time period. I'd like to see what else is in there to make sure we're not missing something. But it's just, I just want to be able to do that. So this isn't, so what it, this just doesn't affect any of that. Okay. All right, well, that's fine. I would like to know, is that going to be okay when we come back? I don't want to just say we're going to have conversations. I want to come back with something in the code to protect the downtown Millville district.
I think it'd be appropriate if you had a motion directing staff to come back at the next meeting with, it could be the first reading of an ordinance to accomplish a tourism overlay in Millville. Is that what?
We're actually just modifying the parameters of the Gateway Overlay District, because we could include Third Street.
Include Millville.
Yeah.
And that way, there's specific action by the city commission directing staff to do it. So if something were to pop up in the next 2 weeks, we can say, well, let's figure out what the city commission is going to do. And then we could, that would be a first reading at the next meeting, because it's an ordinance amendment.
Yeah, so it would be so including.
So it would be a motion to expand the Gateway Overlay District to include the Millville area, and have to work on it and bring back a first reading of an ordinance.
I can't move a motion today, so it'd have to be somebody else.
Well, yeah, I think if you want to pass the Gateway, you can.
Hopefully y'all would want us to do that.
What motion do you need?
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
The motion that I had talked about was a motion directing staff to work on an amendment to the Gateway Overlay Ordinance to include Millville and to bring back to the City Commission at the next meeting for a first reading.
So said.
Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Haligas?
Yes. Well, for my, I've got my Millville people keep me very informed.
Yeah, for my clarification then, Nevin, does that change item 9J's motion, which is the recommendation for the first reading of ordinance 2716.1, which is the future land use map for the Millville downtown district?
I think that
they're two separate.
I think they're two.
That's, Mr. Wayne, so we should still move forward on this in terms of a motion for consideration. Or it's a first reading. I'm sorry, it's a first reading.
Have I not read?
You've not.
You're talking about 9J? 9J.
It's just that, before you do though, it's, I've presented it, and now it's for your opportunity to read them.
I'm going to read something that's not related to exactly the motion that was made previously.
Correct.
But this is the first reading of ordinance 2716.1, ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to include the Millville downtown district category to the Millville CRA to provide for severability, provide for a repealer, and to provide for an effective date.
Thank you. So item 9K is the first reading of ordinance 2716.2, consideration of the zoning map for the Millville downtown district. And on March 26, 2019, the City of Panama City Commission approved ordinance 2675, amending the land development regulations and included standards for the Millville downtown district. The Millville downtown district text was incorporated in the city's land development code as section 104.-35. And the associated future land use and zoning maps were not adopted at that time. Planning Board did consider this item in its regularly scheduled meeting on December 9th, 2019. The motion was made to recommend approval. All members voted in favor of the motion to recommend approval of the request. And the recommendation here is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance 2716.2, consideration of the zoning map for the Millville downtown district.
First reading of ordinance 2716.2. An ordinance amending the zoning map of the City of Panama City to include the Millville downtown district category to the Millville CRA to provide for severability, repealer, and effective date.
Item 9L is the first reading of ordinance 2717.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation and mixed use for the property located at parcel 17525-000-000 East Highway 98. The applicant would like to change the land use and the zoning to be able to build affordable housing on the property. The property is currently vacant. The City of Panama City Community Development is the owner. Michael Johnson is the applicant. Planning Board considered this item on its December 9th, 2019 meeting, and the request was approved unanimously. Recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading of 2717.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for a parcel of property located at parcel 17525 East Highway 98, Panama City, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 9M is the first reading of ordinance 2717.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 3, MU3, for the property located at parcel 17525-000-000 East Highway 98. Same information as I have previously stated regarding the change in the annexation or the agenda, and the request is to move forward with the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading of ordinance 2717.2. An ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at parcel 17525 East Highway 98, Panama City, having approximately 0.536 acres, mixed use 3, providing severability and effective date.
Item 9N is the first reading of ordinance 2718.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for the property located at parcel number 16651-010-000 and 17462-000-000 and 17462-010-000 of East 15th Street. The applicant would like to change the land use and zoning to be able to build affordable housing on the property. Parcel number 16651-0100-000 and 17462-000-000 are currently vacant. The parcel at 17462-010-000 has a storm drain damaged building that will be demolished, and the City of Panama City Community Development is the owner, and Michael Johnson is the applicant. The Planning Board considered this item on December 9th, 2019. The request was approved unanimously. The recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading, ordinance 2718.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of mixed use for parcels of property located at parcel numbers on 15th Street, Panama City, Florida, providing for repealer, severability, and effective date.
Item 9O is the first reading of ordinance 2718.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of mixed use 3, MU3, for the property located at parcel number 16651-010-000 and 17462-000-000 and 17462-010-000 East 15th Street. It's the same information as I've previously stated, and the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading of ordinance 2718.2, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at parcel numbers on East 15th Street, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 2.924 acres, MU3, providing for severability and effective date.
Item 9P is first reading of ordinance 2719.1, amending the future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for the property located at parcels number 20396-000-000 and 20397-000-000 and 20401-000-000 and 20403-000-000 and 20404-000-000 and not the least of which is 20405-000-000. The applicant would like to change the land use to the zoning to be able to build a commercial hotel. The parcel number 20397-000-000 has a single family home that will be demolished. All the others are vacant. Larry L. Adair is the trustee of the 6th Street Land Trust number 2 and is both the owner and the applicant. The planning board did consider this item on December 9th, 2019, and the request was to approve this unanimously, and the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
Ordinance 2719.1, an ordinance amending the comprehensive plan future land use map of the city to reflect a land use designation of general commercial for a parcel of property located at parcel numbers in Panama City, Florida, providing for a repealer, providing for severability, and providing for an effective date.
Item 9Q is first reading.
I'm sorry. Question.
Yes, sir.
On this property, you just up and read about, that's the property that's located on 6th Street and
it's north of 6th Street.
Yeah, right. Martin Luther King and 6th Street.
Yeah, and 6th Court.
Right.
Yes, sir.
And in that area, that is downtown north.
It is.
I read it somewhere earlier that it was saying that it was downtown. And I just want to get it confirmed on record. That is downtown.
In the CRA district of downtown
right.
North. Yes, sir.
Right. And it's in the vicinity of the Glenwood community. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And it's right across from Bay Medical Center. Yes, sir.
Hit the point.
Okay. Item 9Q is the first reading of ordinance 2719.2, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of commercial, general commercial 2, GC2, for the properties located at the same ones that I listed in item 9P. It's the same information as I previously stated in the land use change, and the recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
Ordinance number 2719.2, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at the parcel numbers General McQueen previously read, Panama City, Florida, having approximately 2.05 acres, GC2, providing for severability and effective date.
000.
Thank you very much. Okay, item 9R is the first reading of ordinance 2720, amending the zoning map of the city to reflect a zoning designation of General Commercial 2, GC2, for the property located at 1027 East Business Highway 98 and 1003 East 6th Street. The applicant has requested rezoning in order to be able to convert the property to a multi-family residential. 1027 East Business Highway 98 is currently the nursing home, and 1003 East 6th Street is currently vacant. The request for rezoning of the 4.234 acres from General Commercial 1, GC1, to General Commercial 2, GC2, at 1027 East Business Highway 98 and 1003 East 6th Street. Mark Murphy Holdings, LLC, are both the owner and the applicant. The Planning Board did consider this item on its January 13th, 2020 meeting and recommended approval. As a result, I'm recommending that we conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading of ordinance 2720, an ordinance zoning a parcel of property located at 1027 East Business Highway 98 and 1003 East 6th Street, Panama City, having approximately 4.234 acres, GC2, providing for severability and effective date.
Item 9S is the consideration of a five-year contract with Destination Panama City in the amount of $70,000 annually for both the 4th of July and the Oktoberfest events and event marketing services. This is, you know, we're really blessed in Panama City when we have great extensions of the city, and that's no less the case with Destination Panama City. We're very grateful to Ms. Vigil and what she does so diligently, and by doing this contract, which is a five-year contract, it will help us to be able to better organize and more efficiently and effectively contract for services that support these two key events within the city of Panama City. It's the recommendation to move forward with the approval of this contract with Destination Panama City.
Move approval of the contract. And just let y'all know that the board that she has is fantastic.
Yeah. Especially the chairman.
Yeah, especially the chairman.
Do you want to come up, Jennifer? She's waited this long, she said she's coming up.
Did this so that we would know where we were and what we were supposed to be working on each year. Mm-hmm. One of the things that's in this contract is for the next few years, we have to figure out where July 4th events will be held because mm-hmm. we were fortunate to be able to do it on the marina last year, but this year we're not going to be able to with all of the construction and demolition and having to rebuild the bulkheads and things like that. So before January 31st, we need to figure out where we will be holding the July 4th event. So.
Mm-hmm. Sure, we'll figure it out.
Yep.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Jennifer.
In the bay.
Okay, so we have a first.
Motion. Second.
I'll second motion.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Halagus?
Yes.
Madam Pro Tem, just 2 points or a couple of points of view. Don't mind. First of all, to answer your specific question regarding the deductible, it's 30 for the vehicle maintenance building. It is $32,319 is what will be is our deductible for which we will claim reimbursement from FEMA on. Secondly, there's so many things that are going on in Panama City, and we're so delighted to be able to share just a couple of key events. If you'll indulge me, first of all. On January 17th, it's Arbor Day, and in recognition of that, and I'm so delighted that Ty Ferris has been championing our Retree PC initiative. This falls hand in glove with that. We will be planting 4 oak trees, one at each of the following schools. One is at Cherry Street Elementary, one is at Jinks Middle School, one is at Bay High School, and one is at Lucille Moore Elementary. It's, again, planting another trees in those areas, which is part of our Retree PC initiative to replant 100,000 trees in the next 5 years. Secondly, we're really delighted to have the Martin Luther King Parade. It's the 33rd annual Martin Luther King Jr. March through Glenwood and the downtown Panama City, and it'll begin at noon at the Bay County Courthouse. The third event, which you took action on earlier, which is in the middle of February, which is something we can all put on our calendars, which is February 14th and 15th, which is the crew of St. Andrew's Mardi Gras parade and the pet parade. Those are just terrific events, another opportunity for our community to get together, to support each other, and to support each of these great causes. I thank you for the opportunity to share that with our citizens.
Do we know how many trees we've either given away or have planted? Do we know?
We know how much we have done for the city, and a number of our citizens have shared what they have gone out and purchased. We're also working with Lowe's and Home Depot to see how many they've sold to get an idea. But we're
don't know yet.
We don't have an idea, but it sure is taken off. It's really.
And then I had another question. Why not Northside?
Why not Northside?
Just curious. Right. That's a good question. The only school you didn't mention, so I was curious.
Oakland Terrace.
Oakland Terrace as well. So.
Well, Oakland Terrace is. Oakland Terrace isn't open.
It is. I know
Northside. Northside, yeah. So let me have all of the open schools.
Okay.
How's that?
Yeah. All
the
let me. Can I add one more thing,
sure,
Ms. Chairman? Yeah. As of 10 o'clock this morning, Southern Transportation Building next to Los Anitos is. Down and gone. So next is we get this agreement with Copacabana. That will be gone
on
as well.
Way.
Cleared it up. So I got those pictures this morning. And Southern, it's gone.
And another announcement for Mike. Mike, aren't you doing a coffee?
With the commissioner.
With the commissioner or something?
Yeah,
like
I'm going to do, starting once a month, I'm going to do coffee with the commissioner in St. Andrews area. And so it'll be... You know, for the district, but
sure.
We're going to focus the first one on the area of St. Andrews and just bring people out to, and that is the 23rd of January.
What time?
8 a.m.
At the museum. Oh, mm-hmm. Fun, okay. And then I have an announcement that February 12th from at 5:30, the Center of the Arts, I'm doing Award 1 Just kind of like what you were talking about, just, you know, the four lines of effort, it's what's going to be kind of an update of where we are, where we're going in Ward 1. So that's it then, I guess, huh? That concludes the meeting.
Very good job.
Awesome. Woohoo. All right.